Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 43 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the high honor of chatting with author, speaker, and Yext CMO, Jeffrey K. Rohrs. A creative, strategic, and experienced marketing leader, Jeffrey has a passion for collaboration, innovation, and building dynamic brands in today's fragmented media landscape. His first book, Audience, Marketing in the Age of Subscribers, Fans, and Followers, establishes proprietary audience development and the flip side of content marketing and a modern marketing imperative. The social content marketing blog named Audience the number one social media marketing book for academia, stating that it should be seriously considered as the primary text for an MBA level course in social media marketing. I also had the pleasure of running into Jeffrey in person while he was on Yext on tour when they stopped in Atlanta, Georgia, in addition to being easily the smartest person in the room, which is saying something. He's one of the kindest, most genuine people you will ever have the pleasure of running across. And last but not least, he was the co-host of one of my favorite marketing podcasts, the Social Pros Podcast by Jay Baer and the good folks over at Convince and Convert for many moons. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Jeffrey K. Rohrs. Jeffrey, thanks so much for joining me.
Great to be here.
So you are the CMO of Yext, and by all accounts, the job of CMO is as difficult as it's ever been. Like back in the day, CMOs only really had to worry about print, television, and radio, and now there's like a bajillion different things that you're responsible for. But nobody starts at the top. Nobody starts off as a CMO. Everybody has to start somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with marketing?
Sure. So it is a long and winding journey. I'm actually a recovering attorney. But if you go back into kind of my experience in school and college and grad school, there was always a through line of communications and trying to help clarify and help audiences better understand or appreciate content. So I was a radio disc jockey on a commercial alternative radio station in college. I did plays, I did musicals, I did speech team. I produced and hosted a music video show on cable access in college. And then at law school, I didn't just get a law degree. I did a joint degree and got my master's in mass communication and was using this thing called the internet in 1994 when they put in this new state-of-the-art Power Macintosh lab, and it was all very cutting edge and pretty wondrous. But at the time, there was no money in the internet. It was all very, very new, and I was graduating with about six figures in law school debt. So you go become a lawyer. And I did that, very interested in First Amendment law and copyright and trademark. But as a young associate, you kind of get assigned whatever they choose. And so As I tell people, I did whatever they tell me to law, and that was a lot of litigation, which was not necessarily what I wanted to be doing. And as I looked at the folks around me and what I enjoyed were my interactions with the Lexis-Nexis and Westlaw reps at the time. They were in the midst of, really educating law firms as to the availability of all sorts of electronic resources that they could use to speed up their research process, et cetera. And so I made the move and jumped over to LexisNexis as a rep at a perfect time when they were moving from installed software to an internet site. And so we would say they went to the cloud now, but at the time it was just, hey, this is the launch of Lexis.com, and now you've got to train all these attorneys on using Lexis.com instead of their installed software. And so I had some great experiences there, sat in on some product review teams, got to actually do some product presentations to VIP audiences, and quickly understood that I had a skill for condensing down complex ideas into presentations and marketing materials. So even though I never took a marketing class, I never took a business class, I produced a number of one sheets for my own purposes with my accounts to explain some new products and services, some competitive differentiation. And pretty quickly, my peers that worked with me in the Cleveland area started asking me for copies of those. So I gave them to them. And then I got a call from corporate marketing, and I thought I was going to get my wrist slapped. And instead they said, hey, do you mind if we turn this into a national campaign? And that's when I kind of connected the dots on marketing and communications and all the things I've been doing. Even my legal background provided me with a lot of research and presentation skills. So I subsequently jumped to an end-to-end digital marketing consultancy. I was in the office that was really the digital piece of that in the late 90s. And when that kind of imploded in the bubble, I went to another firm called Optium, which started out as an email service company, not a technology company. And I became a part of the team and eventually president of that agency and growing it to a full-service digital agency, helping build the search engine practice, the nascent social media practice, strengthen the email practice, and build the relationship with Exact Target, where I would join in May of 2007. So I joined them, headed up the partner team for a little bit, and then got pulled over into marketing full-time, built the thought leadership team, content marketing team. I had a hand in the programming of a lot of our events, including Connections, and was a wonderful ride, built a content piece with a good friend and former colleague, Morgan Stewart. That was our subscribers, fans, and followers research series. And it went from what was going to be one white paper to ended up being a 25-part installment kind of series over 2.5 years, crossing many continents, talking about the difference that consumers have in their minds about relationships with brands through email and Twitter and Facebook and all the emerging mobile and social channels. And Exact Target was acquired right when I started writing my book, Audience, Marketing in the Age of Subscribers, Fans, and Followers. And that came out a few years ago, right around Dreamforce. And I was had the good fortune of being able to stay on with Salesforce and kind of tour the globe for a couple of years, speaking to the themes in that book about proprietary audience development. And then I got the itch because, as many people experience when they go through acquisitions, your responsibility set often gets condensed. And while the job afforded me tremendous opportunities and I have a tremendous amount of admiration for Mark Benioff and Salesforce, I really wanted the next challenge to build a team of my own. And out of the sky fell a headhunter with this position at Yext as chief marketing officer. I came in, met with Howard Lerman, the CEO, and quickly assessed that this was a great fit, a company on the rise, and one that I would really like to help succeed. And that led me to a year of commuting from Cleveland to New York, working as CMO, and then having the epiphany that, you know what, it's time we take the risk and move the family to New York, New Jersey area. And the rest is kind of history.
Nice. While I live in Atlanta, Georgia now, I am originally from Dayton, Ohio, where there's a very large Lexis-Nexis presence. So
yes, that was the corporate headquarters. And I actually went to college down at Miami University near there as well. So it was interesting. Lexis-Nexis actually started as an Ohio State bar project. So the original legal database company was spun out of the Ohio Bar Association in Columbus and Dayton, Ohio. And not a lot of folks know that. And I think it's interesting to reflect on that even for marketers today, because here you had this company that was using proprietary search technology against proprietary databases. And when the internet came around, they did not apply that technology to the open web. And you had these companies like Yahoo and Google emerge with search engines. And I remember writing a memo to my boss and saying, hey, this year is actually the 25th anniversary of, you know, the creation of this technology. A, are we celebrating? And B, shouldn't we apply it towards the web?
Right.
And I wish to God I still had a copy of that email, because it was one of my more kind of predictive moments like that. I saw what was happening, but I wish I would have taken it further, because I think that was a missed opportunity for LexisNexis back in the day. And it shows that you have established players that sometimes miss the underlying trend that, you know, is going to take off. And you think about the difference of a LexisNexis owned by Reed Elsevier back in the day, and I don't know the ownership structure now, but boy, that's something I bet they wish they had in their portfolio.
You and me both. I bet they did too. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And it's like, okay, it's time to get down to brass tacks. It's sort of like marriage, right? When you first get married, everything's new and different. She can do no wrong. Then you figure out that this person snores like a dying moose and has all these other quirks. So on the marketing side of things, when did things get real for you?
Well, I think I have to actually go back to why I left the law firm. I jokingly say I learned that being a litigator is reliving the worst moments of other people's lives.
Right.
And that is not how I wanted to live my life. So that was one of the first moments of disenchantment. If I think about the others, at LexisNexis, it was that I applied to be a product manager and got an offer that was for less than what I was making in the field to relocate to Dayton, Ohio. Mm. And that's when kind of the die was cast there that, you know what, that didn't really hold a future for me. I had, you know, certainly a degree of ambition, but I knew where the technology was taking us, and I wanted to get closer to my communication and the technology roots that I was developing, because I saw the trend line. As it relates to my time at Salesforce, it was really just the recognition that it is an amazing opportunity to travel the world and be able to speak to audiences around the globe about marketing and inspire them and hopefully inspire them. But at the end of the day, you come back to a hotel room and your family is not there.
Right.
And so I think that epiphany for me was another important one. Just from a career standpoint, you want to be able to share those with your spouse, with your kids, with family. And that's why it's been great to be able to relocate with them here and share that experience. And it certainly had its ups and downs. But, you know, it is one that is, I think, really fed our resilience, both as individuals and as a family. So when I look at, you know, kind of the theme of those disenchanted moments, it's where I either ran up against a roadblock to what I really felt was a career trajectory that I wanted to take, or it was I had the epiphany that this is not where I belong. I need to make a change.
Awesome. Thanks so much for sharing that. So you have a great deal of experience. And if you had a time machine, you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watched Doctor Who. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
What a great question. I think number one would be, don't be afraid to take risks, especially when you are young, unindebted, and untethered. Coming from the Midwest, having the parents that I had, it cooked into me this little voice of fear about, you know, moving to the coasts or moving to the big city or what have you. It was never anything overt, never anything intentional, but it was there. And when I was graduating college, I had, you know, produced this music video show for two and a half years. I'd been on-screen talent. I'd directed. I'd edited. I literally had produced this thing for two and a half years. And, you know, I did not apply to MTV because I had this, like, little background, you know, of fear. Mm-hmm. I think there was another factor there, and that is that I saw that the music industry was, you know, it had some really, really nice people, but it also was very filled with sycophants, and I wasn't certain I wanted to be a part of that world.
Right.
But I think that's a key thing I'd go back and say. I think another one I would say is, you know, build in the habits that you want to have in 40 years now. It's easy to get caught up in the flow of life in your career, and it's hard to understand when you're in your 20s that years can pass by in a blink of an eye. And therefore, I think you have to have some thoughtful purpose in what are the rituals, whether it's for health, whether it's for intellectual development, whether it's for career development, whether it's for relationship development, but what are those things you're going to build into your habits in your 20s, because that's the type of person that you want to be in your 50s, your 60s, your 70s. That's not to say that you can't change, turn over a new leaf as you get older, but it definitely has a lot more resistance when you try and do that later in your career. And maybe the third one, as I think about it, is I really wish I could go back and tell myself in high school and college to commit to learning a language. As a global CMO of an expanding company, you see the benefit of having knowing a native tongue as you expand, and just the way that it causes you to process things a little bit differently. And that's probably one of my great regrets, is that I don't speak another language. I took German, a little bit of Spanish, and a little bit of French, and none of it really stuck except for the curse words. So those don't really help you, except in certain situations in business.
Sage advice, and I tend to agree. Like I said before, I'm originally from Dayton, and I graduated high school in 2002, but I didn't come down to Atlanta until 2015 rather. And I definitely wish I'd have shed my wings and left for the big city sooner. So I definitely agree with what you said about there being a subtle, nothing overt, but a subtle, those Midwestern values kind of, you know, keeping you where you are. So I can agree with that totally. Now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the areas of digital marketing that I follow is mobile/connected devices/the Internet of Things, whatever you want to call it. And sort of the default example that everyone gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered via Amazon drone. And in that scenario, that's what they call a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house. Everything is automated to the nth degree, just like the Jetsons. And there have been, you know, some concerns voiced by certain marketers, like, okay, are we still going to have a job once things really kick off like that? So as we automate ever more processes and we enter this Internet of Things, how do you see the role of the marketer evolving?
I think it is it's an amazing point in time to be a marketer. It also can be very terrifying, because it can be easy to get overwhelmed with all of the change that's happening. But change has been the constant, certainly in my marketing career and those that are my peers for the last 20 years. When we got out of college, you know, I graduated in 91, we had just started using this thing called email. And we could never have imagined the world in which we live, in which, you know, I've got maps and social networks and all of these ways to connect with people, or bide my time, or literally watch what then we would call television in the palm of my hand, anywhere and everywhere. So I think sometimes you can get a little bit biased towards your own generation, that you know, you saw things that nobody else did. But I think if I think about marketers now, that same pace of change is going to happen. It's just going to happen around different things, right? It's going to happen around just what you outlined. There is going to be a push and a pull around the Amazonification of everything. With the acquisition of Whole Foods, it raises a lot of questions for the sustainability of communities. We've seen a lot of retailers and stores and things, you know, shrink, but we've also seen a lot of change, where there's been innovation that has kept certain retailers growing, perhaps with a smaller footprint, perhaps with more experiential type marketing. And so there is a creativity in that, both from a business and a marketing standpoint, to say, yes, people want convenience. Amazon gives them amazing convenience. But at the end of the day, people still want to connect with people. They want to go out. There's a reason why there's been an explosion of restaurants over the last couple of decades. People want experiences. And so that is something that you can't virtually satisfy. And so a marketer or a business entrepreneur has to think through those things. I think marketers also need to be taking a look at how do they adapt to AI, bots, things that become automated. What are the repeatable processes in their job that potentially go away, and how do you structure a career towards the things that remain permanent? I think it was beyond the realm of belief when I certainly when I came out of school, but even in the 90s, that you could see AP and Reuters and others have bots essentially writing sports articles and writing business articles. But they are, and it's happening today, and it's because the data contained in those is very repeatable, and therefore the articles written off the data are very repeatable, and so they can automate that process. So I think, you know, again, I just from my personal career, I was keeping one eye on the future and where was the trend line. The trend line was always going towards technology. It was always going towards the internet. If I were to look at the trend line now, I would say it has absolutely gone completely mobile. It has gone on demand. It is going increasingly granular, which is a key part of our business, just as consumers want increasing amounts of details on demand in the moment. And as a marketer, you have to be thinking about how do you serve those on-demand needs. But where you can't serve or compete with, say, an Amazon, what can you offer that they perhaps can't? And where are the growth opportunities there? And how do you communicate? It still comes down to how do I communicate and how do I serve a customer's needs? And you can best know that by understanding both their environment, walk in their shoes, but also have an eye on that future and how technology is developing so that you can see the points of inflection where opportunity are created.
True story. And I tend to agree. Tom Webster made a very good point on the Marketing Companion podcast.
Oh, that's impossible. That's impossible. Tom Webster making a good point.
I know.
Come on.
I know. Rare, right? But he said,
I love Tom Webster. He's a good guy.
Awesome. Yeah, real good guy. And so he said that every time something like this happens, there's a shakeup, but life goes on. Like when Henry Ford came out with the assembly line, a lot of people lost their jobs, but on the whole, the economy got stronger. And life goes on. And the same thing happened to travel agents when the internet came about, and a lot of travel agents had to, you know, reskill and find something else to do. But on the whole, the process of booking a flight is a lot easier. The economy is stronger and life goes on. So I absolutely agree with, you know, keeping one eye on the future, but, you know, saying where you are presently, because, you know, I'm not with. Me personally, I'm not afraid of Skynet. Like, I'm just not. You know what I mean? Because there will always be a place for people. So you, Gary V, and Brian Solis, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, Tom Webster, you're all chilling at the bar after the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the present digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Ooh, tough question. I don't know if I can answer necessarily what's missing, but I can answer what perhaps irritates me or what's kind of the pee under the mattress.
Okay.
That's the best way to kind of put it. It's when I hear speakers, and especially younger speakers, just parroting advice and things that they've heard without having data or case studies or real stories of success to back it up.
Yes, Lord.
You know, one of the great things that comes out every year in our space is Mary Meeker's annual kind of state of the internet. And you will see a lot of speakers pick up pieces of that and just kind of parrot it. And there's nothing wrong with quoting her findings. It's a source of research, and it should be kind of distilled. And there should be a lot of marketing thought leaders who think about the implications and then share and amplify those implications at a deeper level with audiences. But it's the folks who don't go to that deeper level where it kind of bothers me. I would say that we also have kind of a saturation point with a lot of events. There are a lot of events that are not very distinguished from each other. They're not differentiated. And I think some of the event programmers need to really be taking a look at what is the value they are truly delivering to the attendees. And I think a reboot is in order in some of those events. There are some that are absolutely great. They understand the mix between the networking that happens, because a lot of the best learning happens when you get attendees together talking, as well as having great on-stage content. But you have to really invest and curate your content for maximum value. And I see a lot of especially events that have perhaps passed hands, like the founders of the event have moved on and it's been bought by this company and bought by this company, and now it's just very mechanical. When you lose that kind of touch with the founder and the person for whom the event was the passion, it is often difficult to sustain the value to the attendees, but they continue to charge for it and they continue to just work the machine. So maybe that translates then into some advice, and that is, you know, for marketers who are really looking for great content and events to attend, look at the ones where the founders are still invested. Look at the ones that have really kind of curated networking opportunities that you're going to be introduced to people, and that are looking towards the future. They just aren't regurgitating what works today.
Yes, indeed. Marketing conferences have been spreading like a venereal disease. There's like a bajillion of these things now. And I tend to agree. It's a lot of it is regurgitated, kind of like what you were saying. And it can be just head spinning, the sheer volume of it. So great answer. So last year, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book called Beyond Buzzwords. And by far, the buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing. Like, it wasn't even close. There are all these podcasts popping up and everybody was about influencer marketing because people were trying to find audiences that were, you know, ever more elusive because the younger demographic had kind of left Facebook for Snapchat because now their parents were on, etc. But those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we got a train wreck, and not just any train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck. I'm talking mushroom cloud, debris everywhere. And we've had actually a few of them this year. We had most recently, we had Kendall Jenner and Pepsi trying to capitalize off of social unrest in a very ham-fisted way that came across as tone deaf. But before that, we had the influencer train wreck courtesy of one PewDiePie. So for those who may not know, PewDiePie is like the original rags to riches YouTube success story. He went from just a guy with a YouTube channel to now he makes about $4 million a year from his channel. His channel was the first with a billion with a B views. And he previously had relationships with Disney and Maker. And the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie fashions himself as an amateur humorist. And he decided to take shots at the website Fiverr and all of the ridiculous things that you can get people to do for as little as $5. But the way in which he chose to go about this was by hiring people to say and do anti-Semitic things. And as you would imagine, the fallout was swift and immediate. Disney immediately ended that relationship. But interestingly enough, they received a bit of blowback from PewDiePie's following, and Chris Brogan made a very good point on the Marketing Companion podcast that the way that younger millennials and Gen Z uses language is fundamentally different from the way that you and I use language, and what offends us does not necessarily offend them. And so my question to you is two part, because there was a backlash from advertisers on YouTube, which YouTube creators dubbed the adpocalypse, because, you know, they were pulling their sponsorships and kind of running for the hills. And social media marketing world speaker Roberto Blake published a very good Medium article on the topic. And in it, he said that since 2013, YouTube has been a real business for creators, yet it's being treated like a paid hobby. So on the brand side, do you think enough brands really think about entering into relationships with influencers, or do they just kind of treat it as another media buy? And on the opposite side of the coin, do you think that these influencers are actually equipped to handle the responsibility of being a paid influencer? Because unlike celebrities like a Matthew McConaughey or Will Smith, they don't have like, you know, handlers or PR agents. These are essentially just, you know, random everyday people whom, to their credit, have managed to garner an audience, but they're not, you know, celebrities in the traditional sense as to where they have training. So do you think that this is something good for brands that they should pursue, or should they sort of, you know, think twice?
Well, you know, my book is all about the idea of proprietary audience development and the fact that, you know, all of these social channels allow brands and individuals to build audiences at scale like never before, and that it's it really is a marketing priority to make sure that your brand is building your audience, and it's not a one-and-done deal. You have to do it over time. And so when you look at why are brands engaging with influencers, it's the exact same reason that they bought advertising or when they continued to buy advertising. They are tapping the audience of a third party. Now, in the traditional mass media days, it was from, you know, extraordinarily well curated, professional, corporate entity building a audience that was very exclusive through television, and it had barriers to entry, and so there were a limited number of people who could reach that many millions of folks simultaneously. Well, now with social media, granted, it's much more fleeting in certain channels, but there are individuals who do not have that kind of corporate background, right? The influencers that have been able to build these channels. And what you've outlined is the inherent kind of decision tree that a brand has to go through. And that is, okay, is A, the audience that this influencer has built right for me? B, they need to do the legwork to understand that influencer's bent with regard to politics and religion and culture and race and all of these things that can kind of blow up. And oftentimes you can't necessarily get at those things because you're dealing with entities who are young and, you know, they are experiencing a lot of things for the first time and you just simply don't know how they're going to react. So that is the inherent risk you take with certain influencers. The other piece of this, though, is the legality of it. I think I saw a stat recently that something like 95% of what is sponsored social content out there through influencers is not disclosed. And the FTC is woefully understaffed to be able to enforce its regulations in that regard at scale. But what they will do is they will pick some of the biggest names and go after them to kind of serve as a cautionary tale so that you get better compliance. Then you have things like, you know, I thought you were going to mention the Fyre Festival with Ja Rule and what a debacle that was. And that whole thing was built on the back of influencers saying, look at this lavish lifestyle. We're going to be able to live, you know, at this wonderful festival on this island that has zero infrastructure. I mean, you could just see the red flags there. But the audience that these influencers had built and their desire to be around the beautiful people and be in this hip scene that was exclusive overwhelmed their common sense to really look at, well, where is this and how is it going to be built out? And even if they had the right amount of skepticism, they could still end up going because they just trust that, you know, nobody's in their right mind going to put on a festival like that that is going to completely fall apart into the Lord of the Flies, and yet it did. So I think brands do need to be cautious. They need to have their own decision structure, and they also have to have a kind of almost a disaster preparedness plan if one of these influencers or one of these efforts goes sideways on them, you know, because they can. Because, again, you're dealing with entities that are not completely proven, but they have the huge audience that you want to reach. And that's the decision that you have to make is the risk worth the reward. And that's true in a lot of different areas, not just influence marketing.
A disaster preparedness plan. That is some sage advice if I've ever heard it. So we're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Jeffrey K. Rohrs. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Jeff, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, speak your mind, because candor is the whole point of this podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news fallout on Facebook and Facebook's subsequent response to it? And just to back up for those who may not know, in the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another, which all news does, right? Because MSNBC leans left, Fox News leans right. There were no underlying facts to be spun, like these were fairy tales. And immediately following, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off and was like, no, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the results of the election. But then in his February 2017 open letter, he conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's current capacity to govern it, and they are in the process of rolling out artificial intelligence or AI and third-party verification to try to curb fake news on their platform. And this has sparked a really interesting debate in the marketing community, because you have some folks who are strictly First Amendment and are like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property, and as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business, and while you're gone, some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool, and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property, and you are ultimately responsible. So again, without getting political, staying more so on the marketing sides of things, how do you feel Facebook has handled this fake news issue?
I don't think there'd be any argument that they've been a little bit slow to move. I think it is an inherently challenging problem, because I think we had a collective naivete about the depths to which some folks would go to perpetrate, you know, kind of lies across the internet. And that's not a political statement. There are lies of all different sorts of times. There are all sorts of hoaxes. I mean, I have been in my entire internet lifespan a regular reader of Snopes. And I remember in the 90s, I had an aunt who would often send me things via email that were completely bogus. And I would go to Snopes and I would pick up the article and I'd drop the link back in and mail it back up to the email chain she had sent. So Facebook didn't create this problem. It just added an incredible accelerant for distribution and targeting. So the idea of fake news or, you know, false stories or propaganda, that isn't something the internet created. Again, it has simply allowed it to have a deeper level of impact. Now, the good news is there should be analytics and data on the other side of that that allow you to assess the veracity of the source. That's one problem I think that the services that have been spreading it have, is that they've been treating all sources as if they were of equal value and equal reliability. When a simple kind of domain check would tell you that this domain has only been around for a year and yet it's reporting something, you know, outlandish. So there are ways, I think, programmatically that you can weight this kind of content and you can push out the bad actors. I believe Facebook is amassing an actual kind of human review team to do it, and that's very tough to scale. So I think this is one of the big challenges for our generation, because we also should put it into, I think, historical context and realize that we have had a complete degradation of our journalistic capabilities in our country and around the globe, thanks to the internet rendering the advertising models of traditional newspapers difficult to maintain. There have been hundreds of thousands of journalists' jobs cut. Their papers are now publishing, you know, not every day. I remember when I was in Cleveland, the Cleveland Plain Dealer, you know, went to, even if you were a subscriber, it would only deliver like four times a week. And it got increasingly thin. And if you looked at the bylines, they increasingly were sourced from non-Plain Dealer reporters. They were from Pools, and they were from Reuters, and they were from other services. So at the time that you have fewer and fewer people doing true, deep journalism, and you have an explosion of not only cable news and sources that rely on it, because all you have to do is turn on, you know, here in New York, New York One, or turn on your local news station to see them just absolutely cannibalize traditional news reporting services, papers now, you know, that have, and their digital partners. But those television stations, they basically read headlines. They don't even have their own journalists going off a lot. And if they do, it's really just a talking head out in the field to give that impression that they're, you know, on the scene. So you have that huge journalism problem. So the professionals, the gatekeepers that we had in charge are gone. You know, the Woodward and Bernsteins, they aren't as plentiful as they used to be. And at the same time, you have the technology adding fuel to the fire and enabling fake news to get incredible traction with hundreds of thousands or millions of people in a short order. And then you don't have the fiscal incentive to kind of debunk it at scale. That's a fundamental problem. That is a real challenge to certainly our democracy that we're all going to have to look at regardless of party affiliation. Because while the perception might be that fake news cuts towards one party right now, it's only a matter of time before it cuts the other way. And this isn't how we should want our democracy to work. We should want facts. We should want valid information. We should want to make decisions based on research and data, much like we want to in marketing. And we know what happens in marketing if we do not look at the data, if we do not look at performance, if companies don't look at performance. The company doesn't exist very long. And the same thing, I think, holds true in terms of what we need to put on ourselves as citizens, and also put the pressure on our representatives, that, you know, if we are not going to base decisions on measurable data and facts out there, there will be a bill to pay at some point in the future. What that is remains to be seen, but I am optimistic that, you know, this too shall pass. But it will only do so if we have a really engaged citizenry that is saying this is unacceptable, as well as players like Facebook saying, you know what, this is a problem. We're going to figure out how to solve it on our end and hopefully inspire others in the industry to join arms and combat the problem, because it is a problem for all.
Yes, indeed. It's a brave new world. So
this whole fake news things has brought into sharp relief the notion of brand safety. Brand safety has really gotten back into the spotlight as of late, especially because we have some debacles with programmatic buying, and larger corporations are able to, buy ads programmatically, mostly display ads. But we've had some, kerfuffles where you have a brand like, Disney advertising on a KKK site. And it's a very complex problem, because oftentimes what happens with these deliverers of programmatic buying is if they don't have enough inventory, they'll, go to a third party partner, which the first party doesn't have any visibility into. So you might have actually blocked certain sites with your vendor, but because your vendor had to, fill the inventory elsewhere, that person still is able to sneak in. So given the complexity of programmatic buying, do you think brand safety ultimately relies with the brand, irrespective of how programmatic is delivered? Or do you think that the vendors of programmatic buying owe their clients more visibility into how those ads are actually served?
Oh, there's no question it's a shared responsibility. And this too is something that has been around as long as the internet. I remember when the infamous first example that hit the pages of search engine strategies probably now 15 years ago was the ad for it might have been Samsonite or a luggage company, next to the article about a mass murderer who put his victims in luggage. So, that has been happening as long as there's been digital advertising triggered off of content. So we need to put that in perspective, right? This is a problem that you're constantly solving for. I think you also have to look at it in terms of financial motivations. So, if you look at Google, and one of the things that I had the honor of doing was help curate the first legal panels in the search industry, and one of those was dedicated to click fraud. And in the early days of click fraud, Google would not even put anybody on that panel. And then as the pressure built from the advertisers, they had a representative and they built a team, because their focus, like any company, is to grow their revenue. And these efforts to try and fix the problems are not revenue builders, right? They are cost centers, until you hit that inflection point where the problems that it's creating for them to sell more inventory or to retain inventory from advertisers begins to hit their pocketbook. And that's just natural. That's not any slight against Google or anybody else. That is how it works. You're seeing it with Facebook, you see it with Twitter, you see it with everyone. So as the companies get more and more pressure from the brands, they build these teams out and they look for better solutions. And so as you look at that, that's why I say it's a shared responsibility. If the brand is just setting it and forgetting it, they're not auditing where things appear, they're not listening to social media and hearing complaints from people who say, hey, your ad is showing up on this site and that's not appropriate, well then the brand deserves what it gets. But if they have those social ears on, if they are auditing, and they see the problems, then they should be taking those actively to whatever ad network that they're working with. And we have seen this to great effect over the last 12 months as well, where there have been fundamental changes in distribution networks, and we now know this is a problem that has to be solved for. Again, it's the exact same problem you had in paid search, and they worked to solve it there. Now it's just with programmatic. It's everywhere. So, again, I'm optimistic that technology can continue to find better and better ways to solve for it. Will it ever get to a point where it's 100% accuracy and you're never going to be associated with content that you don't want to be associated with? No. And for that reason, you have to have your social listening on, and you also have to understand that mistakes are going to happen in business. Your goal is to minimize the chance of them happening, and then when they do happen, be appropriately responsive to your customers or whatever audiences are impacted, and then change your behavior to minimize or eliminate the chance it's going to happen again in the future.
Yes, indeed. One last question. I'll let you get back to your day. I want to be respectful of your time. It's a modified question of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So in my professional opinion, there's a gap in the digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a brand or an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs. And so just in terms of professionalizing yourself, there's sort of three main paths. The first is to just Google it. And contrary to popular belief, while there is a lot of great information out there, a lot of it for free, rooting it out does take a degree of skill on the part of the searcher. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like, who knows where that rabbit hole goes? The second way that you can do is you can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 for my undergraduate. Plus, it's time consuming. Because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And in the online space, a lot can happen in 30 months. But by far, the most prevalent way of educating yourself and disseminating best in class practices that you alluded to earlier is through conferences and seminars. The cons there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less than getting a degree, you got to have that money up front. So some of your better conferences, like a social media marketing World or MozCon, you're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include your flight, your hotel, Uber back and forth, food. By the time you factor all of those things back in, you're easily looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And a lot of folks are in life situations where that just isn't viable. And so what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing yourself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to mortgage your house so you can afford to go to all these conferences. And so now that I'm done rambling for however long, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the skill, experience, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Jeff. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
So I have to ask, is technology the same in this world? So I've got the same tools at my disposal.
Everything's the same. You just don't know anybody and you don't have any money.
So the first place you start is with various social media. Set up your accounts. Start following the people who are not only thought leaders in the space in which you want to work, but think about the folks who are inside brands that you admire that are doing what you want to do, because ultimately this could either be an in-house or kind of an outside agency type of role or consulting type of role that you're looking to build or reputation you're trying to build. And as you do that, I think you dedicate the first third of your month to nothing but reading and listening and going down the rabbit hole of the thought leadership you're presented, as well as researching the folks that are sticking out to you that make the most sense, that seem to be demonstrating the kind of logic and ideas that you admire. And then in the second part of the 30 days, I would seek to try and engage them. If, again, in this brave new world, folks are as accessible as they are today, I can reach out to any number of folks through any number of means. I can email. I can ping them on Twitter, either through a message or a direct message. I can go to perhaps where they're speaking, even if it is a paid event. I can hang out in the hotel. There are a lot of different ways, if you are tenacious and appropriately so, to make a contact. But I would narrow down that list in that second 10 days to the folks that I felt would have kind of the best advice and or the best way to kind of get into the industry that I'm going. In doing that, realize they have a life. What they do publicly in social media is only the tip of the iceberg of that life. And therefore, you need to be appropriately aggressive, but also understanding they're a human being. And I think where I see people make a mistake is they come at somebody as if they are this sheet of paper or this social profile, not realizing the depth of the person. And where folks tend to succeed is when they actually understand the person. And they're not asking for something, rather they're complimenting, or they're asking questions about that person's work. So that second 10 days is really you identify those folks, and now you begin to engage them in ways that ask them questions about their work to elucidate, etc. And now in that last third of the month, you've set up these relationships where you can now begin to ask for something in return, give to get. So you're continuing what you did in the second 10 days, but now in the third 10 days, you can ask for those gets that you need to advance your career or get you where you want to go. I should also say that any marketer in this digital world needs to be producing media themselves. That is one of the best ways to do it. As I mentioned at the beginning of the podcast, I do not have a degree in marketing. I never took a business course. I learned this by doing. I learned this by listening to others, by reading voraciously. I subscribed to a number of different email newsletters, as I do today, and I skim headlines. I'm a big fan of SmartBrief and what they do with their content, because it allows you to quickly digest a variety of headlines. If you look at Inside is another great, quick source where you can kind of read and then go down the rabbit hole of what interests you. And then you can, in your own blog or in your own social, reflect it. And when you do in social and you compliment people publicly, I mean, there are so many trolls out there that compliments cut through the ether. My own little personal story recently is I absolutely love the new comedy special from Al Madrigal called Shrimpin' Ain't Easy that's on Showtime. And I have sat down and watched it end to end. And I swear probably no fewer than three times I've watched it again just by kind of accident. It's magnetic, and it seemed to always be on when I flipped through. And it hit me the other night that this was the case, that I'd probably seen it like four times. And so I just tweeted, and I included his handle in it. I said that, you know, his special is like the Jason Bourne or the Bourne Identity of comedy specials, because I when it's on, I'm always watching it. And he came back and said, wow, thanks. And he liked the tweet. This is somebody that I admire as a comedian. And Twitter gave me the access point where I could connect with him. I didn't go back and ask for anything, but to use your model, that's an interesting way to create the first point of recognition of me as an individual. So how do you take that lesson and apply it in other ways? And ultimately, at the end of that 30 days, you need to be in a doer mode. You've now built this behavior that you can repeat, but you have to start doing. And maybe in those 30 days, you've identified a business or somebody else that you could do some work for, you know, no charge, and say, I think I can get you more customers and I can do this, and, you know, see if they'll take you up on it. Or perhaps you find a business that has a small role that you could play. Or maybe your current job is just waiting for a hand raiser to say, you know what, I'll do the social media. A lot of times the jobs you get are the jobs that you've raised a hand for, not necessarily the things that are on the career path. Hand raisers go a long way in this world. You know, cream rises to the top. So hopefully that gives folks some idea of what you do in that scenario that would prove beneficial in careers today and not just out on Mars.
I hope you guys were taking notes, because you just got a master's class. Compliments cut through the clutter. They do indeed. Jeff, this has been tremendous. Please take a moment. Give us all your social media handles. Tell us about your book, anything you got coming up. Where can we get some more you?
Sure. So if you are someone who has local brick and mortar locations or work for a company that does, I as the CMO of Yext would be remiss if I didn't say you're the type of company we want to work with. We are a digital knowledge management platform that helps companies connect with mobile consumers through all of the different services they're using by enabling you to manage and control that information, ensuring it's accurate even as it changes, be it store hours or location, be it menus, be it events, what have you. And so you can follow Yext at Yext on Twitter, www.yext.com. I myself can be found on Twitter at JK Rohrs, R-O-H-R-S. If you go on Amazon, you can find my book, Audience, Marketing in the Age of Subscribers, Fans, and Followers, and all proceeds of that book go to charity, at least author proceeds, I should say. I think Wiley likes taking their cut for their own use. If you're interested in learning a little bit more about digital knowledge management, I've recently co-authored an ebook with Jay Baer of Convince and Convert called The Everywhere Brand. And you can go to theeverywherebrand.com to download that. But it really will help you understand why you need to manage your brand well beyond your website and app or apps to ensure that customers are finding you and ensure that they're getting accurate information about your people, your products, your locations, your events, your menus, everywhere that it matters today.
There you have it, folks. Definitely go check that out. I cannot say enough about Yext because most business is actually done locally. Even if you're an online retailer, this whole going viral thing, that's a flash in the pan. You really don't want to focus on people in Zimbabwe who will never patron your business. So, go get everything he just said. I can't recommend it highly enough. Jeff, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482.
Please hang up and try again.